Hi, I'm Tom Berkland, author of An Introduction to the Policy Process and professor of public policy at North Carolina State University. I hope you enjoy the book, and I hope you find these videos useful. Well, welcome back for the next video on the agenda setting process. In this video, I want to talk about the idea of conditions and problems and how we talk about problems and how we talk about whether and to what extent government should do something about those problems. So let's talk about the difference between conditions and problems. First, I want to highlight that problems are socially constructed in politics and in the policy process. The problems need to be defined by somebody, that they're not self-evident. Just because something exists in the world, a condition such as poverty or bad weather or something like that, doesn't mean that people are instantly going to rush to defining it as a problem and come to convergence on the solution to the problem. So pro-change groups, that is groups that want to change public policy, must make a case for solving problems. And the reason I have the word solving in quotes is because we probably never 100% solve problems. It's an old saying in environmental policy, for example, and it's well known by economists, that addressing the first 90% of a pollution problem may cost as much as resolving the last 10%. If you've had economics, you'll understand the law of diminishing returns. And so full solutions of a problem may not be available, but progress towards addressing a problem may be. But those pro-change groups have to make a case for solving those problems. Now, Deborah Stone says that problems are defined using things like symbols, like numbers, and like stories about causes. And the goal of all this is to persuade people that a problem exists and can be addressed. So I talk about the difference between conditions and problems. And conditions are situations about which little can be done. And I'd like you to think of some examples. What are some problems out there that you believe just exist and there's nothing we can do about it and government can't fix it? One example I would argue is the weather, for example. Mark Twain is said to have said that everybody talks about the weather, but nobody can do anything about it. And the actual weather conditions at any given time are probably not prone to our intervention, although we've tried back in the 50s, the government studied things like cloud seeding to make it rain more, with, I think, mixed success. But we can say, for example, the weather is something you can't do anything about. But other people argue that things like poverty are something we can't do anything about, that it's just a problem out there. And some people are rich and some people are poor, and that's just the way it is. Other people think that there is something we can do about poverty, about racism, about economic inequality, about ill health. And back to our weather example, an example of something that can be done, we can say, sure, we can't control the weather, but we can build buildings to stand up better in hurricanes, or we can build buildings out of floodplains, so we can respond to meteorological phenomena through public policy, even if we can't control the weather itself. So conditions become problems over time. In other words, conditions that we didn't think we could do anything about become problems that among some people demand action. When knowledge increases about a problem, when technology changes to solve a problem, or when our cultural and political norms change. So for example, the more we've learned about disease, the more we learn how to treat it. Right now, this video is being made during the pandemic. We know that an essential element of the response will be a vaccine, right? So 200 years ago, we might not do anything about it. We might not know. We might not have a very good theory of virology that explains why people are getting sick with this disease. Now we know it. Technological changes also shaped the way we see this problem with COVID. We have a new technology for creating vaccines in record time. So now the government is paying for a lot of doses of this vaccine. So that is another way that the condition of this disease becomes a problem that something can be done about. Now, cultural and political norms change as well. We did have a norm change and a cultural change in the mid part of the 20th century in which people accepted vaccines. Now there's some vaccine hesitancy. which then in itself becomes a problem. And in fact, this goes to the next point, which is that solutions can become or cause problems. So for example, the existence of various vaccines has solved the problems of measles, mumps, rubella, other diseases. The seasonal flu to some extent is mitigated by vaccines. But now that vaccines have been largely successful, a lot of people have argued with relatively little evidence that vaccines are broadly dangerous, or in one extreme case that they cause autism. And that causes then another problem. And the problem is, how do we discuss the value of vaccines for people? So you can see that when we solve one problem, we might create another problem, and then other people need to develop solutions to those problems as well. So the idea to remember here is that sometimes things that we say government can't do anything about evolve into things that government can do something about. And those periods of time in our history where government has been particularly activist, like the New Deal or the Great Society programs of the 1960s, were times in which problems that may have once been defined as conditions were defined then as problems that government could do something about. Now let's talk about symbols a little bit. So what is a symbol? Now a symbol is something that stands for something else. And how are they used as a rhetorical device in policy advocacy? Well, it's pretty clear. The symbols that you might think about are things like the flag, or more abstractly, the Constitution is a symbol. The Constitution is standing for America. The flag is standing for America. An eagle might to you stand for America. To another person, the eagle might stand for a clean environment. Eagles were threatened several years ago with pesticides and other threats to their habitat and to their populations. And so an eagle might mean different things to different people. And this goes to this point, which is, how might the same symbol be received differently by different people? A picture of a poor person, for example, asking for money, might in one person evoke sympathy, and another person might evoke a more judgmental response that they shouldn't be doing that, a normative response that people shouldn't be begging on the street. The battle over what a symbol means and for whom it means it is really important. Even the flag as a symbol of the United States is contested among various different groups. Some groups think it stands for freedom to do, to express yourself in pretty much any way you like, including burning it, which is very controversial. Other people are really offended by the burning of the flag because of what it symbolizes. So symbols are really, really important. So other symbols take root during the course of a policy controversy or as a problem emerges. One of my favorite examples is the Exxon Valdez oil spill happened in Alaska in 1989, and there were a lot of pictures of seabirds, and in particular sea otters, that were covered in oil. And sea otters are creatures that people respond very positively to as a symbol of nature. They're cute. They're what conservation biologists call charismatic megafauna. And that becomes then a symbol of the bad thing that happened in the oil spill, when you had all these poor otters covered in oil. And I personally like sea otters and didn't like to see that. So that obviously yielded an emotional response from me and other people about this oil spill. So symbols are a really important rhetorical device in policy advocacy. They're used all the time. And symbols can be images, but they can also be ideas like the Constitution, or even just the idea of the flag without showing a picture of it. Now, Deborah Stone also talks about how stories and symbols are combined. And this is an introduction to a body of theory that we'll discuss in Chapter 11 called the Narrative Policy Framework, which is a new and exciting theory about how public policy is made. But Deborah Stone talks about how different kinds of stories are told about policy problems and what should be done about them, such as stories of helplessness and control. Deborah Stone, in her book Policy Paradox, talks about things like conspiracy theories as stories of helplessness, that if it weren't for some shadowy conspiracy, there wouldn't be a problem. Or she also talks about anecdotes as typical examples. Back when I was younger, the food stamp program in the United States, which is now the Supplemental Nutrition Program, The food stamp program, when you bought groceries at the store, you actually handed over paper. It wasn't an EBT card, the benefits card, like an ATM card. It was pretty clear that somebody was using food stamps. And anecdotes were told back then about people buying steaks and lobsters and whatnot with food stamps. And so these are anecdotal stories, or you might hear anecdotes about one person who reacted negatively to a virus, or an example that I can call to mind. A friend of mine was in an automobile accident and she was hit and slid across the car. And she claims that if she was wearing her seatbelt, she wouldn't have survived the accident. That's an anecdote. That's a story. The data suggests that people that wear seatbelts are more likely to survive a crash than people who don't. But anecdotes are very popular among everybody. I'll tell anecdotes. I'm sure you've told anecdotal stories, but they're not quite the same thing as data. And in fact, you'll often hear people say that the plural of anecdote is not data. That anecdotes are set up as typical examples, but they're not buttressed by data by and large. They may point to a common sense conclusion that may be supported by data, but oftentimes they're not. A particular kind of anecdote is the horror story. Again, the example I gave you about the people buying steaks with food stamps is kind of a horror story. Or the story of the one person who had an allergic reaction to a vaccine is another example of a horror story. Now, these horror stories are all stories of helplessness and stories of an attempt to gain control over what seems to be a sometimes random world. Now, there's also this notion of causal stories, and I'm not going to get into this deeply here, but you can take a look at this on table 6.1 in the book. But we tell stories about the causes of problems. As the originators of the narrative policy framework explain, humans are storytellers. They call us homo narrans, which is the storytelling human. So we tell a lot of stories about problems. And in fact, the organization of a narrative around a story is one of the most powerful ways of communicating ideas. So keep an eye out as you're studying public policy and think about how do people tell stories about problems. Now, a particular indicator of problems is numbers. And numbers are important because we count things to know more about them. And the numbers reveal problems when compared over time. When something is bigger than it was before or smaller, depending on what it is you want to see, it can raise big concern, such as, say, infant mortality rates. Infant mortality rates, if they're going up, you might say, this is really bad. We've got to do something about things like prenatal health. We've got to investigate other aspects of the process by which babies are born so that we can reduce the infant mortality rate. Oftentimes, we use numbers to compare with other jurisdictions in the United States. For example, at the federal level, we might see that the infant mortality rate is higher in one city than another or one state than another, and we might not want to know why. You're probably familiar with the use of numbers right now in the context of the coronavirus pandemic, where the numbers are on the front page of newspapers and in websites all the time about increasing case counts at the time of this video was shot. The number of people who've died, things like that. Those numbers are indicators of a problem. And in fact, we may not know about the problem with COVID, for example, or other diseases without counting the numbers. This morning, while I was driving to go get coffee, I heard a story in NPR that said that heart disease remains the biggest killer in the industrialized world, even in the face of things like COVID. How do we know about this? Because we accumulate numbers about heart disease. What can a government do about heart disease? Do things like public health campaigns to encourage people to eat better and exercise, not smoke and things like that. Because heart disease is a costly problem. So that's why we count things like heart disease. But some statistics aren't always accurate. For example, does the census accurately count all people or all subgroups? There's reason to believe that it doesn't count all people equally, that certain subgroups like ethnic and racial minorities, certain immigrant groups, are not accurately counted. And that matters because the census is the basis for apportionment of congressional seats, for formula-based aid to states, things like that, based on population. Do crime statistics accurately reflect crime rates? This is a big controversial problem with the crime rate statistics that are collected by the federal government. There's been claims that some crimes are underreported and some crimes are overreported. And so the question is, are the data good? Now, you may respond to that by saying, well, the data may have some random errors in it, but at least it shows a trend. The trend data may be more important than accurate, you know, point counts of the data. And that may be, in fact, the case, but we have to be comfortable with the accuracy or the lack of accuracy of the data we're using. And then, of course, the question is, do statistics measure what they claim to measure? One of my favorite examples is the gross domestic product. The gross domestic product is the value of all the goods and services produced in the United States. Does that measure well-being? Does the gross domestic product measure well-being? Is economic growth in and of itself a measure of how well we are doing as a country? A lot of people don't think it is. Another example along these lines is the stock market. Does a rising stock market mean the country is better off as a whole? During the pandemic, the stock market has been, it dropped, of course, and then came right back up. Is that a good thing or not? Is it measuring prosperity thought of broadly? That's something that people will debate. Education tests are another example of something that's controversial. Do education tests like the SAT, the ACT, the GRE, do they measure intelligence? Do they measure your capacity to do or your capability to do college or graduate level work? These are controversial questions, and we know that, for example, the SAT has tended to have an inherent bias against people from racial and ethnic minorities for cultural reasons that the creators of these tests are trying to find ways to solve. But the reason this is important is because if we want to understand a phenomenon, we might want to measure it, but if our measures are not accurate, this might cause a problem. Well, let's talk about the problems that sometimes we encounter with the use of numbers in policy debate. And I offer this as a form of sort of critical reflection and a little bit of self-defense in the use of numbers in public policy. One of the problems you see with the use of numbers and statistics and policy debate is the misuse of the median versus the mean. Oftentimes we'll use the mean or the average. We'll say the average income in this county is, you know, $100,000 a year, but that doesn't tell you what the middle person makes. Another example is housing values. Usually housing values are expressed as median housing values. If in your community the median house sold for $250,000, that means that about 50% of the houses were cheaper and 50% more expensive. The average does not mean that. The average is just the sum of all the sales divided by the number of sales. And you can have a big difference between the median and the mean, and it can distort what we call a measure of central tendency. In other words, it may not let you know what the middle value or sort of the typical range of values would be. Now, a second problem with the use of numbers in policy debate is the misleading use of charts and statistics and graphs. Oftentimes, graphs will have what I consider to be errors, such as not starting with the zero point on the vertical axis. You'll see charts that will show you big swings in some number. But then if you look at the vertical axis, you look at the y-axis, it'll show that the range of numbers is really very small. For example, if you went and took your temperature today, like six times, and plotted it on a chart that started at 97 and ended at 100, you might have pretty wild swings in your temperature throughout the day. But if you plotted that on a chart that started with 0 degrees and 100 degrees, you'd see that the variation isn't really that much. So people can manipulate graphs to make things look like a bigger change than really exists. And so you have to watch out to see that people aren't using charts and graphs in a misleading way. If you're interested in this topic, there's a great book by Edward Tufte called The Visual Display of Quantitative Information and a series of other books he's published on how people misuse charts or dress them up to make them look pretty. It's what he calls chart junk. But that decoration and that manipulation often isn't very helpful. So if you're interested in the misuse of charts and graphs, reading Tufte's work would be a really good thing to do. And then data and numbers are not neutral information. Data and numbers require interpretation, and those interpretations vary with the interests of the stakeholders. In other words, people choose what numbers to use. And in fact, Deborah Stone points out that the choice of whether to count something is in and of itself consequential. There are some countries, for example, who do not collect in their census information about ethnic categories because they believe that doing so reduces social solidarity by dividing people up into groups. We don't do that in the United States. We collect data on your ethnicity and your racial category because we know we have a historic legacy of racial and ethnic discrimination, and that data helps us to combat the problem. Here's two different examples then of a choice to collect numbers or not to collect numbers and why that matters in policy debate. But the numbers don't just speak for themselves. They require interpretation, and somebody has to make a story or a case for why those numbers matter. So that's it, an exploration into the idea of problem definition and how it relates to agenda setting. I think problem definition is incredibly fascinating, in no small part because there's just no end of examples you can draw upon in your own personal experience and from the headlines in the newspapers and on TV day to day. It confronts us every day. It's something we think about a lot, and it's a really fun process to explore and understand as you delve into the public policy process. Thanks for watching this video. As always, I really enjoy hearing from students and teachers about the book and about public policy. Feel free to reach out to me at tom@tombirkland.com or visit my website, tombirkland.com. Thanks again for watching.